Welcome to another episode of the Red Production Company podcast. I've got the wonderful Sean Dooley and Richard Armitage with me, lead actors in The Stranger. So, Sean, as you're closest to me, let's start with you. How did you get started in acting? What was the path?
Which camera? Straight down that one?
No, joking. Please.
I was a young child, and Richard Armitage was in his 20s, and he came to my school and did a talk. That didn't happen.
I'm not going to tell you who came to my school.
Right, basically, in a nutshell, because I know we haven't got long, I failed miserably at being a vet and being a marine biologist or whatever I could go into to do with animals. Failed everything, failed my GCSEs. Should have got all these sciences and everything, and went to put in exams, suffer really badly with nerves and tension when I got into kind of an exam situation. So I would get into exams and just clam up and not be able to do anything for the whole exam, whereas my coursework was all A's and that. So I got one GCSE on a C instead of eight, and so basically, consequently, my whole career trajectory was done and over. You're going to put violins behind this, by the way. Yeah.
Yes, yeah, of course.
Good. I've actually got a single tear coming. It's going to wipe it away.
He's been saving that all day.
Okay. And he's heard it before. I haven't, I haven't. Oh, yeah. I'm just fascinated that you weren't a vet. You'd have been really good as a vet.
I'd love to be. I still want to be. I want Attenborough to kind of go.
I saw you quite good with animals, aren't you?
Yeah, well,
stroking dogs and. Sorry, go on.
Stroking dogs.
Stroking dogs.
Still on the CV.
And so basically, yeah, the pits were shut in, which would have been my kind of next step following my dad's and granddad's. Dad and granddad's. So it was all gone to pot, and I used to do once a week a thing with Barnsley Youth Theatre, which used to be around, you know, once a week. And I went into them, and I told them the week before about my failing my GCSEs. And then the following week I went in, and they said, listen, we've had a chat. We think you should become an actor. And here is a play called The Caretaker that I'd never heard of. And they went, and this is a speech by Aston. Read this speech, learn this speech, read the play, get it under your belt, and we've got a date and time for you to audition for a BTEC course in acting in Barnsley. And they basically, I didn't know at the time, but they handed me a life in a way. Without that moment happening in my life, there is no way on earth, I would be saying, no way on earth. It was never an option. It was never a career that somebody like me would have chosen or thought I would be capable of doing, and still don't really think, you know, it should be. But anyway, so handed me that, went to BTEC, got in that BTEC course, went to my dad, first, and went, listen, they think I should become an actor. And my dad, in a very un-Billy Elliot kind of way, said, you're going to be unemployed whatever you decide to do because of the pits and everything, so you may as well be unemployed doing something you like doing. Basically, I was handed it by strangers, in a way, which is
by
amazing.
The Stranger.
A bunch of strangers. By it was you! No, it wasn't.
And then you went on to Arden.
Did a degree at in Manchester, and then left and was the only person to leave my year without an agent.
Oh, wow.
So then I was like rock bottom, totally pointless, over. And then did everything to get my equity card, which I was the last year that needed an equity card. And in order to kind of prove you were an actor, which I still think is missing today, and I think should, you know, I think something that was invaluable back then, because you had to kind of graft to get there. I had to do theatre and education for 6 months. I had to do plays in the middle of nowhere, just purely to get points, to get my equity card, to then be able to say, I am a legit actor and I can work.
Yeah.
And I think it is, I do wish it was still there, I think, because it just, means you've got to graft, and if you're going to prepare to graft, you're prepared to go a little bit further than just somebody goes, oh, do you know what, I want to be famous.
Richard, what about you? How did you get started in acting?
Talking of Billy Elliot.
You didn't.
I was sent, for some reason, I can't figure it out now, I was sent to tap dancing classes when I was four.
Wow.
So I don't really have a memory of why I was there. I wasn't very good, although I liked the music. I think I had quite good rhythm. But I was always being told, smile and look like you were enjoying yourself. And I got to about 9, and I suddenly thought, why do they keep saying smile and look like you're enjoying yourself? Because if I was enjoying myself, I'd be smiling. Yeah, yeah. So I kind of travelled on that line for a while, and I was bullied for it as well. And the problem with me is, as soon as you try to push me down or say you can't do this and we don't think you should do that, I immediately push back. Mm-hmm. So I decided really young that I was going to try and make a career out of it. But nothing to do with film or television. It was always theatre. I joined the Scouts so I could do the gang show. Mm. So I ended up going to a vocational school in Coventry called Paterson College. And then when I left that school, I hadn't been to a big London school and needed an equity card. So ended up joining a circus in Budapest for 6 months to get the points to get my card. Got to a circus, I didn't know what I was doing. I was throwing hula hoops at skateboarders and waving feathers around and holding onto ladders for jugglers. But came back with an equity card, mm-hmm. and then started going for auditions that were advertised on the back page of the stage newspaper. Yeah. Yeah. And doing classes at the same time, heading towards musical theatre, mm-hmm. which I did for probably 4 or 5 years. I was a hoofer. That's nothing to do with animals. I know it sounds like it. I did that, and then realised I was still having that tiny voice at the back of my head saying, "Smile and look like you're enjoying yourself." And I'm like, "I'm still not enjoying myself." And that's when I decided to kind of have like a little career shift and went back to drama school, because mm-hmm. I'd always been a reader from really really young. I'd always just devoured books, and I realised that it was the other side of my creativeness that was driving me, the sort of literary side. So I went back to drama school quite late, mm-hmm. At the age of 23. It's quite late for drama school. But still, I was always focused on theatre. I didn't in a million years think that anyone with my face and my nose, which was referred to as Concord when I was a kid, belonged on a screen. So I had absolutely no kind of aspirations to be on film in any way, shape or form.
Following on from that, do you think drama school is a good place to go? And two, do you think it's essential? Because I know a lot of young people, they will audition for drama school, audition, thinking it's the only way into the industry. So how important do you think drama school is?
I first of all, I don't think you have to go. Mm. And yes, I do think it's a good place to go. Mm. I don't think they can really teach you how to act. But what they can do is teach you all of the skills that you need when you try to work in the industry, which is changing all the time. I think when I was at drama school, they taught me how to make my voice survive over, 8 shows a week for a 12-week run, which when I did the Crucible at the Old Vic 5 years ago, I really went back to all of that training because I was about to lose my voice on the first preview. So all of those skills that they give you, but in terms of the instinct to be an actor, I don't necessarily think anyone can teach you that.
What do you reckon, Sean?
No, I totally agree. I think one of the good things about drama school is being in an environment, I suppose, with people who are also striving to set off on that course, and also a place where you can fail. I think I went back and taught a bit at Arden. I taught naturalism and Stanislavski and all this. You wouldn't believe that, would you?
Stanislavski?
Yeah. And because he was my hero at drama, he was massive. And what I did love about my drama course, we did no telly. We had one day telly with a lovely lady called Maggie Ford. So when I did my first telly, I had no idea what to do because we were taught that we were predominantly theatre. Mm-hmm. What we did do is we studied all the different practitioners of theatre, and we were left to then choose what you wanted to choose. Yeah. And, you could all just pick little bits of different people and theorists and just take a bit from everybody you want and hang on to that. Yeah. So it was never forced that you had to be a particular kind of way. And I really loved that element of it, of just finding all these, Arto and Brecht and all these things, just going, And it was nice to be able to have 3 years to be able to do that. However, saying that, my BTEC course, I think, prepped me even better for life, because in that BTEC course we did And do you know what? Annoyingly, I heard the other day, I had some kids talking. It's become, BTEC's become a bit of a derogatory word now, and it's yeah, and it's become a bit of a thing.
It's got the letter B in it.
Yeah, A-tech. And which is really not fair, really. But in that course, we did set design and lighting, sound design, and had across the spectrum, learnt. Pretty much had a little walk in different shoes, which was amazing. And I think that for everybody to then be able to then leave a job, and you know, Rich is very similar on set, just to kind of go respect for everybody else's jobs within the machine of making something.
I'm usually looking at everyone else thinking, I wish I'd done your job instead of this one.
Is there anything you'd dip your toe into on the other side?
Ooh. I'm always fascinated with editing, but I love production design as well. I look at when you arrive on a set and the detail just blows my mind, and I think that's a really interesting job because you're doing something similar to what we're doing, which is creating the illusion of life, which is so believable.
Yeah.
And I originally, if I was clever enough, I would probably have been an architect. So. I look at buildings and I look at sets and I'm sort of instantly fascinated.
So you kind of said that you like to take different bits of different methods of acting, different schools. What about you, Richard? Do you do similar?
You know what? There are a couple of teachers that have crossed my path all through my life. Probably I can count them on one hand that I still retain all of the detail that they teach. And I didn't realise it at the time, but Di Trevis was one of them at drama school. She came and worked with us on our second term. And literally everything I do now, there's always something that she would have referenced in the work. Even when I'm reading an audiobook, structuring things and just the honesty of everything that you do. You know, it's the two schools of one is pretense and the other is truth. Mm. And some people think that acting is about turning up and pretending to do something, and the other school is turning up but you know, convincing yourself that something is real. Mm-hmm. And I prefer to sit in, I think they're both valid actually, but I prefer to sit in the one where I believe it's real. Mm. And it came from that teacher.
Yeah.
I'd really like to go back into a drama school and try and take everything that I've gained in the industry and try and impart that knowledge to kids that are just starting out, because I think TV and film technique is something, it's so kind of complex and complicated.
Yeah.
And being able to sort of literally drop into the middle of a scene and pull out one shot from a whole kind of scene of high anxiety or humour, and to just find these pieces that you have to do it a lot on film. I don't know where the technique comes for that.
It's hard, isn't it? Because it's just almost kind of learnt, isn't it, over years in a way, isn't it?
Mm.
And it is difficult. I mean, we little daft things like hitting your mark for a scene and not looking down at your feet, which if you watch some of the old films, you beautifully see them walking to set and then go. And then stop.
Yeah.
And it's beautiful.
Yeah.
It's really lovely. But the first time I was asked to hit my mark, I was this kid from Barnes, and I said, "Who's Mark?" Oh, you know, if it keeps me in the job.
I only learned Split the Difference about a month ago.
Did you?
Yeah, I've got no idea what it meant.
Split the Difference.
Brilliant.
Yeah. Do you know what? My first class, if I was to go back into drama school, and I'd be like, so the title of my first class would be Hitting Your Mark on a Horse. I'd be like, bring your own horse and then hit your mark on a horse. So you have to get the horse's feet on the mark so that you're in the right place.
That does sound like a skill that
I heard that recently on
The Witcher. It's like trying to get the horse to hit the mark.
And they say, you can ride, can you?
They put a sandbag down for the horse.
So is there any kind of specific advice you would say for someone who's done loads of theatre that wants to do screen, or is it so kind of a myriad of things that if they want to cross over? Because I know a lot of people want to do more screen stuff but have come from a theatre background.
I don't think there's a crossover.
I think it's just a volume thing.
Mm-hmm.
I think you still have to go. I mean, the beautiful thing about, God, if you could put them together, the beautiful thing about theatre is having 3 weeks, you know, if you're lucky, if you're unlucky 3 weeks, which is what I've normally had, or if you're lucky 6 or 7 weeks, mm-hmm. to find the character, to develop the character, to work on the character, to find the through lines, look up absolutely everything in minutiae and then get rid of it for theatre. That's why I think we all love doing theatre. Whereas telly, you're basically in your hotel room doing it, or you're on your own. We it don't happen very often. We met up before big nights of filming and worked together on stuff. But quite often, you don't work on stuff. You know, there's no place to fail. In television, is there anymore? We used to, when we first had you get rehearsals, but and for me, I think it's the same technique. It's just, you know, still striving to get that truth, still striving to be believable, and for yourself to believe in what you're saying and to listen to somebody else talking and how they're affecting you. But it just happens on a stage, you're doing that more than that, I think.
Yeah, you're right. It's just truth, but at a larger scale. Something that I struggled with really early on when I was starting out, when you're a little bit unsure of what you're going to do and what you're capable of, and because I was always in a rehearsal room because I was a theatre actor, there was always this voice at the back of my head saying, "You'll do it on the day," or "You'll do it when there's an audience in," or "You'll." And actually, something that I've taken from TV back into the rehearsal room for theatre is that, in a way, television is like one long rehearsal. So every take is just another rehearsal that you commit to fully, so that when I'm in a rehearsal room now, I work as if we're filming everything and everything's usable, even though there's no audience in the room. You're trying various versions of the scene. All of them are correct, none of them are wrong. And I think if you work in that way all the time, no matter where you are. Volume is it's you still. I think on stage you still can work in close up because there's somebody sitting 3 feet away from you. But also you have to engage probably your body a little bit more. That you put that on film and someone would be like, "What are you doing?"
Just you're probably out of shot by that.
But also I think as well, in the sense that when you're on stage, I might be wrong here, but in the sense that when you're on stage, you've got a, Stanislavski called it circle of concentration, you've got another circle that's in cooperating an audience and where you're stood and how you're, where your physicality is to an audience, blah, blah, blah. You've got camera, which is one audience member looking at you, and I think that's some of the technical stuff I've learned. And I don't look at that and go, "That's an enemy." I enjoy. It's always a third. You know, we've got this. It's always a third person that's in the scene in a daft way, and I like the fact that technically we have a little dance around this inanimate object that is one audience member looking at you, and I really like that. And there's a lot of people who. I think the thing is, like, if you kind of go all method and blah, 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 and shut that out, that's like going on stage and going gadoosh and putting a curtain down and kind of, you know, well, I don't know, I'm probably talking bollocks, but...
No, not at all.
Well, the idea, it's the implied narrator of the scene is the camera, so... And that viewpoint impacts how the scene is played out, you know. I did think about the idea as if you set up a 360 camera in a room to film a scene, it would be completely different because you wouldn't be having that snap viewpoint. I think it'd be actually impossible, but I thought, you know, something like 12 Angry Men, you could theoretically, because it was basically just one long take and see what happened, really.
It's also nice, it's very nice when you work with, I mean, we get exposed to so many different types of actor in the career, but when you work with people that come from theatre, they never stop the work when the camera's not on them. They're always in the world, and I really enjoy that. I think that's the one thing about theatre that you don't necessarily get on film, is you're far more in control of it. So when the play starts, you know that you're driving it and you will continue doing this for the next 2.5, maybe 3 hours, sometimes 4 hours. And on film, there's always someone else that will say cut, and you think, "I was just about to have a moment." But to be in the driving seat is actually quite satisfying.
Just moving on as we are, strapped for time. Because you sort of said you were the one that didn't leave with an agent out of your drama school. How important do you think an agent is, especially early on? Is it get one as quickly as you can?
It's so hard. I think it's so hard for people. There's the number of people leaving drama colleges has upped. The number of charlatan agents that are out there who get kids who've not got very much money to pay monthly so that they can be represented, which I think are just scum, to be honest with you. and take the money when you've earned it, or take the money off these kids before they've earned it. It's not fair. It's a message to any of you out there, if you listen. Sorry, got a bit angry there. What was I saying? Yeah.
Is it important to get an agent at the start, kind of as quickly as you can, like a good agent anyway?
It's so hard. I don't know.
I think
it's the aim, isn't it?
You know what? I've seen many of my friends and colleagues, I've seen people function in the industry without an agent. Mm-hmm. It's much more difficult. Mm-hmm. I think it's crucial, really, yeah, to creating a long and healthy career. You do need somebody guiding you, because you, most of the time, you can't even get in the door without someone, yeah, on your behalf knocking on it, mm-hmm, with the right people. Mm-hmm. And in a way, it was going back to drama school. There were two reasons why I went back to drama school, because I didn't have the confidence to move into an industry without the, in a way, the qualification or the, yeah, the certificate. But I also knew that I couldn't function in the industry without an agent, mm-hmm, and drama school was the only place to really cultivate that.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah. Is there anything that you feel has changed dramatically from the start of your career towards the point now? Is there anything that surprised you on the way?
My face. I mean, please, can I just like pick it up off the floor? It's really hard to age on screen. Over 20 years, it's really hard when you look, yeah, back at stuff
and see
you've
it.
Done.
Yeah, I know. I go,
oh my goodness, you've really got to embrace that side of it. Mm. You know,
I used to be the youngest on set. Always for like ages. Like, I'm always the youngest on set.
Do you behave differently now, though?
Yeah.
Do you still behave like you're the youngest on
yeah,
set?
Yeah, I do. What's changed? What's major things have changed?
Or something that surprised you that you weren't expecting about the industry when you kind of started out?
I think we're moving in a better direction now, mm-hmm, towards more... Is the word inclusivity, mm-hmm, is that a word?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Which I think is sadly lacking in our industry and needs to be addressed and should be addressed a long time ago. And different jobs, people being educated in different jobs, I think that's starting to open up now to different people from different backgrounds. And I think that's, as far as I'm concerned, the more you open up, the more talent you're going to get. Mm-hmm. And it's as simple as that, really. It's nothing to do with where you're from, or, you know, it's just you open out you open your search wider, you're going to find better people.
Yeah.
And so I'm glad about that. I think that's a really good positive thing. And even daft things like the amount of female directors I'm now suddenly being directed by, and it's great. Mm-hmm. It's really nice, because different people bring different things and different backgrounds, different experience, life experiences, they bring that to the table, and they can't help but make it all better.
Yeah, I think.
Actually, there was something I wanted to add to what Sean said about inclusivity, is that, you know, no matter how much confidence you have, or how in my case, lack, you know, I always felt like a misfit or an oddball or that I didn't belong. But I always told myself that you exist in the world, so therefore there's a place for you in this industry. And I think anybody who feels like I can't become an actor because you exist, and we're, you know, the job of filmmakers is to write about our life and society. Yeah. And if you are a part of that, then there's a place for you in the industry.
Thank you for watching this episode of the Red Production Company podcast. It's been absolutely wonderful to have Sean Dooley and Richard Armitage with me.